On the night I was born, the rain was pouring. God was crying, lightning struck, power outage, sparks was flying. The real ones here, the young boy that walked with lions. Around the outlines of chalk where the corpse is lying. Of course I'm trying to revive a sport that's dying. But the guns and the drug bars that y'all relying. Got these nerves thinking that you niggas hard as iron. But that just mean I ain't as comfortable as y'all with lying. Stretching the truth, no I never stress in the booth. They feel the pressure, me I feel like I just left a masseuse. Effortless, how I'm skating on these records is proof. I put your favorite rapper neck in the noose, never letting them loose. Cold world.
What's up, everybody? Thanks for tuning in to another episode of Yurt Pod, where I discuss all things weird, paranormal, and creepy, cryptids to conspiracy. I'll cover it all, baby. So let's talk about it, man. There's been a lot of things going on recently. If you've been seeing the news, you've been seeing social media, the articles popping up, the stories being shared, you'll see that UFOs aren't just weather balloons. That's interesting, right? I mean, places all across the country are showing things in the skies. But I think there's something else going on today. You know, most people, they want to focus on like, oh, the government is telling us something. The government's actually providing some form of disclosure. Well, ladies and gentlemen, disclosure has been happening for a while. The subject has been eased on to the human populace. People are conscious of them. People just push the thought of UFOs to the back of their thoughts. Could be real. That's as far as it goes for some people. And in fact, the phenomena of things showing up here that shouldn't be here just gets glossed over all the time. I'm a Bigfoot guy. You know, I was just talking to some close friends of mine on the subject. You know, while they're talking about UFOs, I say, well, you know, well, what about the Bigfoot phenomena? Things have always been here. Oh, that's not real, or that's different. How? I want to know, how is this different? See, the government wants to focus on UFOs, these metallic drone-shaped UFOs that are starting to pop up with flashing lights all over the country, stationary even. I mean, we saw the example of the woman on the plane showing a UFO stationary in the sky, planes flying about 400 to 600 miles per hour, zips right past this UFO. It appears as if the UFO is tilted up with its belly facing the plane and moving just as fast. Well, I beg to differ. I think that thing was stationary and was just maneuvering out of the way of the plane while the plane was flying towards it. But that was a metallic UFO. Not to say that there isn't metallic UFOs coming from outer space. There's a possibility behind that. But the government is focusing on just that type of UFO. I've always said to people, especially because I come from the Bigfoot world, the Dogman world, the cryptid side of things, if they are arriving to this plane of existence, we have to figure out where from. If these phenomena are coming here and being seen, are we to think that they're coming from UFOs? That's a possibility. A lot of people who report these encounters talk about seeing things in the skies. Orbs. Balls of light. Translucent in shape. Very slow. Very slow. Seems like these things just hover and glide through the trees or glide above the trees. And sometimes they're huge. Well, the government's not talking about that. Government's not talking about that, ladies and gentlemen. They're talking about physical things. And if you ask me, there's a real possibility, given tech reverse engineering and the efforts towards reverse engineering that we've discussed on this podcast, that have been happening for decades. We're talking about people like Bob Lazar who have come forward on a number of platforms. George Knapp, an amazing journalist who's covered this phenomenon for decades. Okay, we have had the tech. Some of it even bleeds through into our commercial side of the of things. Industry. You know, there's a great old saying that the microwave would have never come into existence if it hadn't have been for the Roswell crash. The understanding of microwave technology. You know, and when you listen to people like Diana Pasulka, who is a professor, I believe, of theology, she's had numerous podcast interviews where she's talked about our reverse engineering programs. But I ask again, why is it that the government seems to only focus on the metallic shiny saucers? This is a form of just disclosure, obviously, and I think that they are slowly gearing people's understanding, or brainwashing, if you will, slowly getting people used to the idea that there is something else out there. Will they eventually talk about the things that are coming through these portals being observed in places like Skinwalker Ranch, Blind Frog Ranch, ranches throughout Arizona and the West? Who knows? But we do know Native American cultures, indigenous cultures from around the world have talked about this stuff. Talked about stargates, pyramids, harmonics, frequencies, vibrations, rituals that allow some of these phenomena to bleed through into our reality. You know, and I don't have to dig into every single culture and why this is, to me, all connected. But I've just seen so much in the last couple of days that is being promoted by the algorithms of the internet. And to me, it says, well, everybody's worried about the internet being a tool to steer the youth. Well, I mean, it's telling me something. You know, I'm seeing Vice documentaries talking about voodoo not being a evil, a force of good. It's a force of good. Voodoo? We're talking voodoo. And why is it being promoted by my algorithm alongside alien UFO videos? But then when I actually click the link, because I'm a curious mind, they have these, and I want you to look it up, ladies and gentlemen. Look up the Vice special on voodoo, and you'll see some of these traditions and festivals that they have. People are floating. People are sitting in fire. People are cutting themselves or attempting to cut themselves with no success. With sharp objects, all claiming the power of voodoo to be real. There was even one segment of this festival. It happens towards the end where I thought it was a guy dancing in some type of grass suit. The suit is made out of some type of straw, some type of long grass blade. And it spins around like a top. It almost looks like an imitation of a UFO flying around. In fact, a lot of the voodoo traditions, the Haitian traditions even, Nigerian traditions, host this spinning dance style with some type of sheath over the person where he throws it up in the air, and even that's a circular floating UFO, if you ask me. To the trained eye, you'll be like, wow, it's like this culture has understood that things from the sky, spinning things from the sky, circular things from the sky, these saucer-like things, come down and give certain people power. That's what I picked up from it. And then when I listen to people like Diana Pasulka and her theories, talking to some of the biggest names in research behind this phenomena, they say, well, we believe that these UFOs may be some type of device allowing things to travel through time. And that would promote the theory behind many of these saints. If you dig into some of these religious saints, especially in Christianity, there's a lot of talk of encounters with otherworldly beings that come from craft that look exactly the same. And if we look at the data from around the world, we see that all these indigenous cultures participated in some form of polytheistic belief systems that promoted the idea of these sky people coming down and giving select ones power, or manipulating reality for others, who provided some type of ritual, some type of sacrifice or prayer to them, and that these forces were very real. Now, in modern times, you would probably scoff at that idea, right? You know, the thought of someone trying to alter their reality by chanting and dancing and prayer. It sounds ridiculous, right? But people like Stephen Greer have studied these ancient cultures, ancient texts, worked with the Pentagon, and has come up with the CE5 protocols, which is a form of meditation that results in people seeing this phenomenon. How does someone come up with that? Huh? Or has this information always been out there? I think that the religious text warning of these end times might have some credibility to them. These things have been predicted. In other words, you notice that if you dig into this realm of undiscovered science, if you will, it seems like the occult has a strong foothold in the information that's being provided. The government will tell you on the news, all right, we got some UFOs, we're tracking them with radar, we're starting to see them. Wait a minute, brother. We're starting to see them using scientific instruments because we've calibrated them correctly. But people with visually, physically have always seen these things. So with that said, more people are starting to see these things. These things are starting to pop up more. What is going on is the true question. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull up the video with Diana Pusalka. I am extremely fascinated by this person. I feel like she is extremely intelligent, incredible, and knowledgeable with everything that's happening in this type of disclosure era that we're in right now. So I'm going to play some bits from her. Let's check this out. This was her interview with Project Unity. And Jay from Project Unity, shout out to Jay and Project Unity. He asked some tremendous questions, but he's very educated on what Diana is talking about. All right. So we're going to go ahead and give a little clip to this extremely, extremely great interview. I encourage all of you to check out this full interview. I'll even provide the link below and you guys give me feedback, because I would like to talk about some of this stuff, man. This is wild. This is a blending of religion, technology, and human evolution that most people in very well-respected realms of science are starting to speak up about and say, hey, man, this is real. This is the reason why we're starting to see a lot of these things. This is why people are becoming more receptive to a lot of this information. So let's go ahead and jump right into it.
Some of this more philosophical necessary kind of prerequisites, you know, is there, for example, an evolutionary prerequisite for us to in some way meld spirit and science together, connect intuition and logic, physics and metaphysics, in order for us to progress our perception of reality? Do we need hemisphere synchronization between what many consider to be opposing worldviews, spirit, science, when in reality, perhaps the clearest picture can be divined when these perspectives are in some way married together? What do you think?
Yes, I don't see a duality. And yeah. This has been a theme in all of my work, even with the book on purgatory. This idea of separating spirit and matter, you know, the separation of spirit and matter, which, you know, is really just a framework of perception. And I think that, especially when there's talk of this, the UFO, you know, and the back engineering of the, you know, what this is, and there's no talk of the weird experiences that a lot of the people who allegedly say they work on the craft, or the parts and things like that, you know, their experiences doing that and the kinds of research that are being done with respect to interfacing with it, right? As a, some type of, I would call it like, some people call it, I can't remember the term that's used by some of the scientists, but a multidimensional object. Yes. So I'm in agreement with you. And I think you said that very well, actually. I don't think I can say it better.
Well, thank you.
Multidimensional objects. Let's think about that real quick. Where have we heard that before? Multidimensional objects. See, it isn't the government that's going to provide the disclosure. It isn't institutions of major academia that is going to provide the disclosure. They may provide outlets of research and development, but a lot of this is going to be grabbed up by, as you know, the capitalist side of things, that I need to make money off of this. This is going to the private sector. Like people like Elon Musk. You think it's a coincidence that people like that are tapped into position to not only understand the tech? I think it's because they understand the tech. They have the cognitive ability to actually understand the tech, and they get the tap from the government. We've heard people like Joe Rogan talk about this. As long as you can figure it out, you'll lead the market. You'll lead the industry. You'll lead in innovation. And then those same people somehow end up with these mergers behind companies that really influence the human day. I say that because how does the man creating AI, creating reusable rockets, creating brain chips, how does that person get the keys to the algorithms that affect every person's day? As soon as they log on, as soon as they open their phone, drinking a cup of coffee in the morning, taking a poo, they're seeing videos that determine the outcome of their day, basically. They're getting hand-picked information specifically geared for them through the form, through different social medias. And here we are, this billionaire who's created PayPal, all this other industry that has influenced humanity, and they're back at it again. And they're talking about UFOs too. In fact, they're putting a whole bunch of stuff out there. AI, robots, everything. Is it a coincidence that disclosure comes from these types of people? Or is it a coincidence that the technology that we've always had but never understood gets put in their hands, and the innovations created from the back engineering slowly trickle down into the public sector? And slowly the thought process begins once we see that we're capable of something. Well, I could see a UFO in the sky doing that. We have jets that can hover stationary. We've had that for decades. That UFO could be a drone. Okay. But see, what's happening is people are becoming more receptive to the idea of something that we've never seen before being there. So much so that they're even providing excuses as to what it could actually be. But what about the phenomena that the government and these major people aren't talking about? The stuff that the everyday person is talking about, like the orbs, the balls of light. I ask that again. See, I think, and I've said this on many podcasts, that y'all got the game messed up, bro. Y'all got the game messed up. these things, in my belief, some of them may be coming from space. Maybe we have a moon with a base on it that, you know, some Men in Black stuff is happening on, where all the aliens of the universe stop there and check in first. And maybe some craft have to come down to this plane of existence. Yeah, that's a possibility. But why? Why? You know, the last UFO flap that I would say the generation before us can understand was the UFO flap that occurred when we started dropping nuclear bombs. Dropping nuclear bombs on each other, testing nuclear bombs. World-ending potential right there. We start seeing these UFOs pop up, right? So maybe, just maybe, all these UFOs come from planets that were so technologically advanced, they could detect bombs going off on our planet and said, let's check up on those things. I don't know what those bursts were. Let's go just go check on them. No. I don't think curiosity would promote an intelligence to go check out the destructive forces that are occurring somewhere. That's like saying, hey, there's a large solar flare about to occur. The data showing us a large solar flare is cooking up on the sun. It may be headed straight for Earth. Let's get in our ship and go to the solar flare, because we won't die first or anything. You know, there's no potential for that. It just doesn't make sense. But what does make sense, if something did exist here that was at risk of becoming cannon fodder for reasons out of its control, and that would be humanity being a destructive force on this planet, but being ignorant to the fact that you exist on that planet. You know, I'm thinking of like Wakanda. You know, like, let's say there was this Atlantean mystical civilization that was still here, somehow hidden from us. If we started throwing nukes, maybe they start showing up because they live here too. Maybe the veil is very thin. The dimensions, the other realms, the parallel universes that occur on Earth or host Earth, maybe they are here too. And we're not designed to see nor detect that world given our natural abilities, at least yet. And that's why we create this. That's why we have this drive to create technology. That's a real possibility. But I tend to agree with people like Michio Kaku that said, you know, what are the chances something would put in so much energy, eons of understanding and learning, to say, you know what, let's travel to the next closest planet. Matter of fact, let's go to the furthest planet away and let's just start scouring for life. We've done that. We've sent out satellites, people. We've sent out satellites that have now been like 20 to 30 years old, over a billion miles traveled. It sees Earth and it still has seen nothing else other than planetary bodies that host no life. But it's still out there. You know what the crazy thing is? Is we're not sending humans out there. We're not sending our own people and life out to go check for other planets. No. We're using things like trying to understand the quantum realm, and if teleportation can really happen there, how can we manifest that in this reality? Maybe then we'll be able to access the stars better, the planetary bodies around these stars better. But it's all for nothing if we can't prove that life exists on the planets that we're trying to connect with. And that's my thing. Our understanding of these UFOs seems to be so directed. This disclosure thing could be all one massive false flag event to convince people that this is all that it is it's us. It's us. When in reality, there are some real strange and quite frankly, evil things that people report experiencing after seeing these other types of UAP, UFOs, these balls of light, radiation poisoning, even encounters with beings that, quite frankly, if you ask me, look demonic. You know, it's not the standard gray alien with bulbous eyes and a round ball, or, you know, bulbous head, you know, gray three-fingered being. No. Some of them even report these, like, Sasquatch-like beings, werewolf-like beings, beings that some people call the Rake or the Skinwalker, are coming out of these balls of light. So you're telling me there might be a whole planet of werewolves and Bigfoot? How? There's a whole planet in outer space with beings that look exactly like the creatures that we have on Earth, but in a man type hybrid form. That's strange. And somehow the dog faced being figured out how to fly UFOs and come to Earth. Like, is that what I'm supposed to believe, people? Because, like, if we're taking in the data, let's take it all in. This is what people are seeing on one end of the spectrum, but it's only the government talking about the metallic saucers that we've been studying and having, that we may have. I think we said 12 of them. You know, David Grush, UFO whistleblower, just came out. High credentials in the intelligence sector. Multiple intelligence sectors, too. No, he's had all of this information and just out of nowhere throws it out there. People used to get threatened. Their lives used to be threatened. They've testified about it. They've talked about it on numerous podcasts. They've even shut answers down live saying, I can't talk about that. I'm in fear for my life if I talk about that. But somehow we have an uncut interview on the topics of UFOs at a time where we're basically in a cold war with Russia and China. Our U.S. military is whistleblowing. And we're to believe that this is genuine? That this isn't some psyop to convince people that, hey, UFOs are here for us. That's like saying, oh, herd immunity is real. You won't get sick from COVID if everybody has it already. Your immune system will get used to it. It'll build itself up for protection. It'll fight the virus if we're all fighting the virus. We learned that that was BS. It's coming from these same people, though. So, I don't know. I truly believe that these things are coming from another dimension, another reality that has existed here, i.e. the spirit world. You just heard Diana Pasolka and Jay from Project Unity podcast talk about that. This isn't her only interview either. She was on Concrete podcast talking about the same thing.
I can easily see the parallels in between how the rot or the institutionalization of Christianity and the institution that, wow, easy for you to say, institutionalization of the UFO phenomenon, how it has always been like this incredibly stigmatized topic. And now they're making it more mainstream so people can, I mean, there's so many blockbuster TV shows that cover this topic. It's almost unfathomable. But that's the thing, that the government isn't necessarily talking about the ancient aspect of it or the religious side of it. They're talking about it as it's just technology or like quote unquote aliens possibly.
Yeah. So I think this is interesting. I think that the one thing that shifts this, makes it different from the Christianity example, you know, I would say that UFOs right now are having a Christianity moment where there's, you know, the institutionalization going on. But the one thing that's different is that whereas the other was the focus on we have the divinity, or we, you know, the Catholic Church is the one who has the access to the divinity. It's an interesting shift in that this divinity is secularized.
Can you define secular?
Oh, yeah. Secular is not religious.
Okay.
There's no religion here. But that completely goes against what I'm looking at. So I'm happy to call it secular if that's what I found. Like I said, I don't care. You know, I'm not here promoting, you know, the existence of this or that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just doing my job, which is basically to see what I see and then make conclusions based on what I know and the data. And so what I find is that the very people who are most immersed in the study of even the quote unquote technology are having experiences that I would call religious-like experiences. And these are changing them and shifting them. They live really almost like monastic or ascetic lives. So to not include that as data is probably, and well, let's just put it this way. I think it's interesting. I'm including it because that's what I see.
These people are talking about the occult and secret societies, the Knights of Malta, the Vatican, and Satanism. Why specifically Satanism? That's the thing. And why promote these other, why is the algorithm promoting things like voodoo and other spiritualities? It's almost like this is straight out of the Bible. The end times prophecies where these societies would start to show themselves openly and the ignorant people will side with them. It's a spiritual warfare. And the sides are starting to show themselves. The sides are being drawn and people are aligning subconsciously and consciously with what they believe. And it shows through the comments, this virtual world that people live in, man. And now when you open your door, you're just starting to see UFOs. And the question is really starting to stick. Well, we're not alone, but people aren't asking, well, what are they?
My previous view on this whole phenomena was like it's very technological. And as soon as anyone started to mention anything about poltergeists or mysticism or, you know, anything that is paranormal, I started to like take a huge step back and be like, okay, I can't take this person seriously. But after reading your book and hearing how all of these people report all these similar experiences, even though they don't understand what it is, but they describe it to you. Like, for instance, the guy, Grayman was his name.
Yeah.
He had a crazy experience with this being hovering above him at night, and he described it to you, and you said what he described to you was to the T, the Saint Michael,
yes.
The Archangel.
Yeah. He didn't even know it.
There's been some incredible videos that I've posted on the Yurt Facebook page, as well as the TikTok page. You guys can check that out at YEARTPOD. One woman even has sent me video of this blue orb coming down the street, stopping at a certain point. Two beings made of what appears to be light just pop up and start what looks to be like creating a portal. How is this happening? People don't think that there's any coincidence to this. Like, all of a sudden, the government says, all right, UAP and weather balloons, we shot some down. That expands to whistleblowers coming up from high-ranking government positions to a major forest fire happening, our skies being darkened via the smoke, and people in the darkest parts of the country, as far as the smoke, New York City, for example, it looked like a post-apocalyptic world out there. You couldn't see the sun, you couldn't see anything, but you could see stuff streaking across the sky, right? Freaking people out, people not understanding what exactly is going on. And as soon as the smoke clears, even more UFO videos are being posted of things stationary in our skies. But the government disclosure is real. Huh. I don't know, people. This is something that you really got to make up for yourself. I've provided enough of my perspective in the last couple podcasts, especially as to what I think these things are, the connections that I see between these phenomena, and it could all be wrong. We could be living in a time where reality just consists of this much. And for eons, we've held a natural understanding and natural consciousness that put a mental block up on what reality actually was. And this could just be that understanding starting to fail. This could all be our consciousness changing, our frequency changing, our vibration, if you will, as some yogis like to promote. So I'd say watch some more of those movies you like, the fancy Disney ones that kind of promote the same ideas of the UFOs and other dimensions and other realities. And then they're just keep ignoring it, thinking that this is these are just stories, as if storytelling hasn't been a cornerstone of human consciousness this entire time. Go ahead and just treat these stories told to the masses as if we should just gloss over them, that it's fairy tales. Because, you know, these same stories have been talking about developments in quantum mechanics, quantum science, and understanding UFOs and this type of technology, as well as beings that are different than humans living right amongst us, impacting humanity, and all this occurring while being hidden. I mean, how are these stories actually starting to show some validity? I don't know. You know, people, if you've ever seen that movie Interstellar with Matthew McConaughey, that was an award-winning film about the theory of relativity. And in order to save the world, Matthew McConaughey had to travel at a speed in space that would take him so far, so fast, that in, let's say, a certain short time period for him, an exponential time period would have actually taken place on Earth. Meaning if he was gone for a year or 6 months, it would actually be 30 years on Earth due to the theory of relativity, the impacts of the theory of relativity. The faster you go, the farther you go, the more time has passed for what you left as opposed to where you are. So these people do their research in order to make a good film. This isn't just storytelling. This is real information being shared through someone's perspective in the form of a story. Our superheroes, our tales of superheroes, are the same as the tales of the gods that these ancient cultures told themselves. It's so crazy that even in today's times, these Marvel movies, that's all it is. Namor from Black Panther 2. What was he? He called himself, he told people, I am Quetzalcoatl. I am that god. They even gave you a hint as to this director's perspective on, oh, you know, we always talk about these ancient cultures. Tenochtitlan, the Mayans, the Aztecs. How did they just disappear? We don't find no bodies. These pyramids are here, but they just disappeared. No skeletal remains, no nothing. Well, Namor or Quetzalcoatl in Black Panther 2, he manipulated his genes and his people's genes through a process that was kind of sort of the same as to how the Black Panther got his super strengths and abilities with that plant. So we're talking about gene manipulation, interference with the humans, and the societies created from this level up in consciousness. But these are just stories, ladies and gentlemen. Don't take anything I'm saying for facts. It's just interesting that these are the ideas that are being thrown out there. You know, one thing about Jesus Christ is that, from my understanding, and I'm not the most religious person in the world, is that he spoke in a way that the people with the ear who could decipher his parables and his coded languages were able to understand. They had the cognitive ability to break down what he said and understand it. And they chose to follow him. And then they, with their perspectives, provided word to the masses once he was gone. His disciples provided this information to the masses once he was gone. This is storytelling, ladies and gentlemen. There's some credibility in it. There's a reason humans have this drive to communicate these stories, because there's so many things to decipher from it. How many times have your parents told you something when you were young and you're still resonating and finding ways to find value in what they said in the many instances of life that you find yourself in? I think people need to start looking at the bigger picture. You know, broaden the scope a little bit. Do a little research into what humans are coming up with, who we're becoming, our level of understanding. Because it's truly fascinating. You know, I don't want to keep you guys too much longer. I just had to get this off my chest because so many things have been happening this last week between the David Grush, the Diana Walsh Pasuka, documentaries on both Concrete Podcast as well as Project Unity and a number of others. This has been a crazy, crazy time to be alive. So thanks again for tuning in, everybody, to another episode of Yurt. I hope you guys enjoyed. Check me out next week for the next episode. It's going to be a banger, ladies and gentlemen. You guys have a good night. Bye. See you. Some see the glass is empty. I see a glass full of ether, collecting his bread and mash like he a Catholic preacher. Just to count a nigga cash, you might need a calculus teacher. Eureka, Einstein on the brink of the theory of relativity. Really, no MC equal. Feel me, Copen be lethal. Crip like an old MTV show. On God, the best rapper alive. Headshot, not going ass. The best rappers that died, they tell you he never lied, nigga. Yeah. Tenor talk.